Hey, everybody. My name is Malik Foster, and I am a co-host for the Counterpoise podcast, and I'm joined by my lovely co-host here.
Hey, everybody. I am one of the other Counterpoise podcast co-hosts, Samantha Adams.
And I am your other host, Everett Stevenson, and today we have a good fortune to be joined with our lovely guest, Ms. Shantae. Would you like to introduce yourself as well, let the people know who you are and, what you look to bring to us today?
Hey, everyone. My name is Shantae Tidwell, and hopefully I just bring a positive yet fresh perspective to the topics that are going to be discussed today.
All right. We appreciate it. And today we got a good one. As we all know, more recently, we've been seeing that there's war bending in Ukraine, and we noticed that there's also a lot of African students and residents, that's citizens rather, that are in that country that are looking to try to leave during this wartime and a time of instability. And so recently we've seen that there were information that was going out that shows how they were having struggles with getting across the border. And we noticed that that was something that wasn't really necessarily a new thing, but it's something that seems to continuously be happening. And so we want to kind of shed light on some of the struggles that we've noticed that people of color have had, in particular people within the Black diaspora, whether it's African or in any nation that they may be in, when there's issues of turmoil, how they normally are disproportionately treated in a negative rate. So before we jump into that real quick, we're going to go ahead and look at African economy and talks about, you know, some of the things that make this country of Africa such a great company with country with resources and things of that nature. And I know Malik has some more information on that.
Well, before we do that, E, I want to jump in because I actually have a clip where it's talking about a lot of the things that are going on over there in Ukraine. Specifically, like when everybody was in quarantine, right? And we were, watching things unfold as it related to George Floyd, Ahmaud Arbery, all of that. You saw in all these different nations how African people of African descent, let me not just say Africans, because they're definitely, you know, British people who are Black, right? People of African descent protesting about the treatment of Black people in their own respective countries. And a lot of times, you know, you hear about how, oh, racism isn't that bad over here in blah, blah, blah country, or it's not as bad as it is over there in the United States. But the truth of the matter is racism, and we see it happening everywhere. I'm sharing my screen right now. Can you guys see my screen?
Oh, it's coming up.
So this right here is a quick, I don't know why it's still going. It's a quick video where it's providing with this young lady right here. She talks about her experience in trying to get across the border from Ukraine into, I think it was Poland. So I'm gonna go ahead and unmute that and press play. You guys let me know if you can hear it, okay?
The official Ukrainian between my eye and said,
yes.
Only Ukrainians, that's all. That if you are Black, you should walk. I'm currently in Debrecen, Hungary. I got in like 10 a.m. today. Today's the 28th of February. It wasn't easy. On Friday at 8 a.m., I was on my way to Poland. I took a commercial taxi and the taxi couldn't stay on the line of cars because literally cars have been there for 2 days. And when we dropped, on the Google map, it was saying a 1 hour walk. And I was like, oh, 1 hour walk is nothing, you know, if it's getting us there on time. And we walked and it kept increasing. The term walking is traumatizing me. The term walking, I walked for 12 good hours. hours, and it's not an exaggeration. The traffic warden saw me and said I should go to a shelter to sleep. And I slept, and he said the next day that there is a bus going from that shelter straight to the Polish border. And when it was time to get on this bus, the Ukrainians said, just Ukrainians, literally as a Black person. I even lied that I was pregnant. They didn't care. I was begging. The official literally looked me in my eye and said, in his language, only Ukrainians, that's all. That if you are Black, you should walk. And that was an additional 8 hours from where we were. By car, it was like 30 minutes. So we had to walk additional 8 hours. The problem isn't at the Polish border. It is at the Ukrainian border. Because you have to stop out at the Ukrainian border to get on the Polish side. And the Ukrainians are only prioritizing their citizens. They don't care. They will push you. They will beat you. If you can make it, you make it. If you don't, you don't. Like, I took a nap and I still felt like I was still walking, like I hadn't crossed over. It's not fair. Like, we're just begging to go. I literally had to go back to my city after the experience, re-strategize, and took a train to Hungary. It wasn't even easy getting to Hungary. We had to pay. Those that didn't have money to pay, what would they do? I couldn't help anybody because I was fighting for my life. It is a traumatizing experience, and I don't know where I'm going from now. I literally have to re-strategize in Hungary, try to get my ticket back to Nigeria because it's not safe. This place is not, if your skin is dark, you're at a disadvantage.
And that's from BBC. That is a terrible experience. Imagine having to walk. I don't know if the total amount of time she walked was the 8 hours, was the 12 hours, or if she ended up walking 20. I just know that was 24. I don't know. I just know that that was quite an experience. And I just wanted to just make sure I put that out there so that people would be made aware that these are the types of things that are happening. You know, you're hearing about when people are getting out of Ukraine, like I think a bunch of people ended up in Berlin and there were people just gathered there waiting for people that got off the airplanes and trains and stuff saying, hey, you can come stay with me. I have one room, I have a couch, I have a place you can sleep, to try to help. And that's a beautiful thing. But the fact that Black people are being treated like that, I thought was pretty disgusting. You know, you guys want to go ahead and jump in?
Yeah, it's pretty horrifying what's happening over there in Ukraine, and in terms of how they're treating the, you know, African people over there, people of African descent. And I do want to point out that when it comes to the whole Poland situation, I did see a video about a guy who did try to travel to Poland, and he said, you know, the people of Ukraine are fine and the people of Poland are fine, but it's mainly the authorities, right? And the people in charge, the people in power that are doing the discrimination, right? And the blatant racism. So this kind of makes me think of the situations over here. Like, maybe the everyday folks are okay, you know, they're not really oppressing you, but when it comes to the authorities, like, for example, the police, or, you know, maybe people in power, some legislators, or companies and stuff like that, those are the main problems and main issues when it comes to this oppression stuff. And we're kind of seeing that here in this case, right, in the Ukrainian case, right, where there's African residents there, and they're trying to seek refuge just like the other Ukrainian citizens. However, they're being treated in a different way, like the whole back of the bus situation all over again. Like, you're not getting any type of priority based off of your skin color and your race. So that's really eye-opening, hopefully, to a lot of people who feel as though that, you know, racism is over and things like that. I think this sheds a lot of light on it, and to let people know that this is a global thing, a global mistreatment that Black people, people of African descent experience all over the world, that we're very disrespected.
Absolutely. And to that point, I wanted to bring up a clip that I had seen while I was watching NBC News. And I'm going to go ahead and share my screen with you guys. Let me know if you guys can hear this.
Some Black immigrants tonight say the journey out is getting harder and harder for them.
Mostly, they would consider white people first, Indian people, Arabic people, before Black people. As long as they're Black, we can like to.
And so, that was a clip that I saw when I was watching the news. And I think that it kind of goes towards some of what you said earlier. Like when you're Black, and especially sometimes when you're Black in America, you understand somewhat of what it feels like to be in a country and to have that oppression. But I've noticed sometimes we also are used to living in our day-to-day that we don't realize that seems to be the struggle for a lot of Black people around the world. And when we've seen this young lady, you know, who, like she said, was a student, and to Sam's point, like 20% of immigrants, I guess, like you said, foreigners in that country were students from Africa, who was there looking to get an education, and then instability occurs, and now, you know, they're looking to try to get to safety, and they realize that, you know, one, that you don't necessarily have protection from necessarily your country and the ability to be able to get you home safely and prioritize that you're that you get home in a good manner. And then two, also to see that, you know, that the country that you are a guest in are willing to, you know, kind of push you to the side and make you feel bad is horrible to see, especially for women. I think there's other clips as well that show gentlemen who had to, you know, endure the same thing. And I think that man referenced how, you know, they were watching animals get placed on the buses before sometimes they were allowing humans to. I believe Malik maybe made this statement. I don't know if it was on air or not, but had the nerves to ask someone to fight in the war with them. But you know, you see how you're being treated even when you're trying to leave, and you asked me to stand in here and to fight with you. But to the point, like, how was you treating me when I was here? How did you treat me when, you know, when you had the chance that things were good? Now that you need something, now it's kind of like, oh, can I help you in your time of need? But before I even had a time of need, or even when I'm asking you to look after my sister or whoever, look after my like kind, you won't even have the decency to do that. And so I think that kind of goes to the disrespect that we see a lot of times within the way that people are treated. And it goes to us needing to be able to realize that we're stronger united than we are against each other, and understanding that also a lot of times that this struggle is one that's going to happen no matter where you are and what you're doing. So it's best to kind of know that and move with that in mind, even no matter regardless of the privilege that you may have and that you find yourself with.
I think it's interesting to note that the president, Muhammadu Buhari of Nigeria, stated that, you know, under the UN convention, everybody who's trying to flee a conflict situation is supposed to have the same rights across the board. So it's interesting. I think there's something that I wouldn't be surprised if something actually came from that, especially since Nigeria then sent 5,500 troops over there. So that's important to note, because I'm sending folks over there to help you, and look how you doing my children, essentially. Imagine you letting some your children go over to someone's house, and they said, hey, tell your mama to give me some sugar too. I done ran out of sugar. And my child come to you, bring sugar, and you mistreat my child. You see what I'm saying? That's the same thing that's going on in Ukraine when it comes to our Nigerian brothers and sisters. And the fact that they're there to further their education is mind-blowing. And to be completely transparent, it's heartbreaking, because whether we're in America, whether we're in Ukraine, whether we're in on the continent of Africa, those are our people. And just to see your folks being treated like that, you know, that's hard. And, you know, you're sitting here at home watching on CNN, BBC, MSNBC, all these showings of what's going on in Ukraine. And to know that some of those things are happening at that, while that's happening, y'all not letting my folks out. That's major.
Right. And it's also too, like, racism is it's a reminder that racism takes no days off. Like,
absolutely,
there's a whole war going on in the Ukraine and people still find time to be racist. Like, I understand the whole thing about letting women and children get on the trains and stuff first, but what color their skin is should have absolutely nothing to do with it. And it was me. It was a story I saw about Ukrainian government asking a Congolese man to help in their fight. It's like, you didn't let my sister, my wife, my girlfriend, my daughter, my whoever, shoot, even my brother, get on a train to leave. And you're going to ask me to help you? Like, you can't stab me in the back and ask for help at the same time. That never works. It never has worked. And anybody with any good sense would say no.
I kind of have probably a little bit of controversial opinion right now about how one of the people that were interviewed talking about what was happening in Ukraine were saying, oh, they're letting white people first. Why shouldn't they not let white people first? Because, I mean, think about it. It's their country with their citizens. You have to just oppose that to your family. Are you going to take care of your family first or another person's family first? You're going to take care of your family first. So I understand, like, you know, taking care of, you know, your family first, or in this case, the Ukrainian citizens. But where I disagree with what's going on is the fact that they're saying women and children, and they're not letting the Black African women and children go on. You know, even if they don't get on first, they're not prioritizing the way they should. You know, they're basically lying. So I don't like that part about it, what was going on. But I do understand, like, when you're in another person's country, they're gonna treat their citizens with more priority than you. So I'll say this about the United States. If you're overseas and, you know, there's something going on, they'll come get you, right? They're going to communicate. So that's one good thing about the United States. I'll say that. Even though we're still mistreated over here, they'll still come get you. So that's one thing. So I think African nations, specifically Nigeria, they need to learn from this. I know we're going to kind of get more into it a little bit later. But I did want to get anybody else's thoughts into it.
I just wanted to add on to what you were saying, and that's what I meant by, like, saying, like, your nation should be able to step up, right? Because you know that whenever there's times of instability, or I keep saying that term, but, like, there's war times or anything like that, you have American House Councils in a lot of countries where you can go run to there to seek to try to, you know, get help from your government. And I think, you know, with these African nations being such powerful resources, or having powerful resources, that they should be able to make sure that their students who are going to continue to, one, come back with their knowledge and understanding and education to help build up the country, feel safe. Because, you know, if that's like, those are the people that are building the foundation for the countries a lot of times, are the working class and the educators and things of that nature. So I think that, yeah, this is a letdown that we've seen. And I know there's an article that we're going to get into a little later that talk about some of the responses that, you know, the Nigerian country had in regards to outrage.
Yeah. So about that article, so there was a little article via African Vax Zone and another website as well, a Nigerian publication, that stated that the Nigerian government approved $8.5 million for relief for some of the evacuees. Is about 5,000. So they have 5,000 citizens over there in Ukraine, about that number. And they are gonna give them each equivalent of 100 US dollars for their pain and suffering. I mean, that's really not enough. in my humble opinion, but that's what they're going to do. But this kind of goes to show that, like, these African nations need to really invest in their people, right? Because you shouldn't have that many people abroad everywhere, okay? You have 5,000 in Ukraine, but there's Nigerians and Africans all over the world trying to leave to see better opportunities and better lives because the Nigerian government or the other African nations aren't providing what they need to be providing due to maybe corruptions, bad contracts, bad deals, all kinds of stuff. And they're not really trying to reinvest the money into the people to provide better opportunities and more incentives for them to stay and get the education in their home country, because there's a job waiting for them, right? They need to build up the countries because that's what they need. They need more buildings. So I just wanted to mention that.
Well, one thing about that, though, Malik, is, you know, these African nations, they have a different type of oppression, right? Like, apartheid didn't end until 1989. That wasn't even that long ago. And on top of that, you know, the oppressors in that country are the minority of people. However, they control the majority of what's going on in the motherland, which is a complete different contrast from what goes on here in the United States, because, you know, the oppressors here are the majority. And so, you know, a lot of that, the reason why you see a lot of people escaping has to do with the structure, like you said, but that oppression and the brainwashing that has happened. You know, there's also too a whole lot of division amongst Africans, not just within those different nations, but even amongst people of African descent, right? You have propaganda, the way that they see, the way that we are depicted on in media, on TV, on social media, all that stuff. What they see from us is what people want them to see as opposed to who we actually are and vice versa, right? Like, we often see, they look at us and they think that we're lazy and all we do is shuck and jive and sambo around because that's what we see on TV. For the longest, you would see the depiction of Black people and all they're doing is telling jokes and playing ball. That's it. Like, almost like you can't do anything serious. Meanwhile, we're looking at Africans and we're looking at them like they're savages because they show them living in huts and throwing spears. Do they do that in certain villages? Yes. Does that make them a savage? No. But is that the majority of the African nations and how they're set up? No. Are Black people all we do shuck and jive and joke? No. Like, this America is still running on the backs of African American people. Like, you know, we're a majority of the frontline workers. We do most of the blue collar jobs. We still raise people's kids and take care of a lot of things. We are the reason why our economy continues to move, because Black people are the highest consumer of anything, you know, despite inflation and everything else, and the fact that we don't make any money and we're treated the worst. We're the bottom on the totem pole, but we still hold it down. And so I think a lot of that, you know, when you're talking about, I agree with you, Malik, that African nations definitely need to take better care of their people. But I think that the corruption has to be exposed first, because you're just going to continue to see that vicious cycle. That's the reason why it's still like that. Some of these countries are still fairly young. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. I said, apartheid ended only in 1989. That wasn't that long ago. And so there's some of them are still just trying to figure it out, whereas you have some countries that are just extremely corrupt.
And Sam, really quickly to your point, nail on head is exactly what I was thinking. You know, America is an old country. The United States, we've kind of gotten to things a little sooner than other countries. You know, we are the greatest nation, you know, in the world, best military in the world. So when it gets to things like better education, people come here for a better education. You know, a lot of people, and it's not just Nigerians, it's, you know, I don't even want to limit it to the naming the countries, because this is supposed to be the melting pot. So many people come for so many reasons, because they can't get those things, because, like, we're talking about Russia right now. Russia was the Russian Soviet Union
up until 1991. That wasn't that long ago. You see what I'm saying? So, you know, there's a time frame, a big lack. I remember apartheid. I was literally in grade school and that and learning about it as it was going on. So it's some things that they don't have a grasp on as strongly as we do yet. So yeah, they should take better care. And do I think they're going to get to that? Absolutely. Because it's conflicts like this that teach you how to do better in the future. Because we had conflicts that taught us how to do better. And we are by far nowhere near where we're supposed to be, especially with how we treat our Black folks here. But you know, those are lessons that have to be learned, and it sometimes it takes time.
Absolutely. So I'm gonna go ahead and jump into some more clips real quick that we have from recent articles that we've seen. This first one that I'm going to go into is a young man who documented his journey coming back from Ukraine.
Not much light can be shed on that on their part.
So he's just showing like how there was like a grass shortage.
It's a bit of a sticky one still.
All right, and then
if I got a chance to, I will never, no, never neglect you. I mean, who am I to hold your back against you? I just hope that it gets to you. I hope that you see this through. I hope that you see this through. What can I say? Please recognize I'm trying.
Just a clip of a young man who made it home safely. And then here is a clip of, you know, the young man
They told us, like, we are going to give you guns and you're going to fight for Ukraine. I said, hi. We're going to fight for Ukraine. We are not Ukrainian.
Right.
So how can we fight? How can we fight for Ukraine? If we fight for Ukraine, we're going to die first because we are Black. When they will say, oh, look at those Black people, I think they are from they are from NATO. So we have to kill them first. So how could they think that way? Come on. Ukraine.
You know, let me just say something about those two clips that you played, E. The first one, that boy walked for 35 hours. Let's really just think about that for a second. It reminded me of, remember when the people in South America were trying to come across to America and then they started kidnapping their kids because they were in a bad situation? Think about that for a second. If you are forced to have to walk across country, literally walk, this is not Forrest Gump make-believe running across country. This is real life, people literally walking. You walk for 35 hours so you can be safe. And then to get to the border and they say, oh, you need a car. Like they don't know what's going on in Ukraine. That's the part that throws me off. Like, y'all know what's going on over here, right? But we need a car? Why? You can't just let us, we clearly don't belong here, right? We're African. We don't look like Ukrainian. We don't sound Ukrainian. Here's our African passport. Can you please just let us through so that we can get to safety? And they're like, nah, you need a car. Like, why would you make that harder? right? And, you know, as far as the gentleman, the tone of his voice says a lot. Like, he's kind of laughing, he's kind of joking, but sometimes you have to laugh to keep from crying, because that right there is, it's sad. Like, they're not even from that country. They're trying to leave. They're trying to get out and go home. And you're saying, oh no, here's a gun, go fight.
Because you asking your citizens to step up and do this, that, and the third, but then again, you know, we clearly are seeing at the same, in the same breath, how you are treating others who aren't your citizens and who may be my, who are likely my kin, to looking at how you treating them, and then you want me to go ask me to take up arms for you? You know what I'm saying? Come on, where's that same respect? It's unconscionable. Unconscionable. Because it's just like, how could you even think to ask me that? How could you with a straight face like come at me like that? I get you need as many men as you need. I understand all of that. I do. But on a strength, you need to go ahead and make sure mine's is good. If we step in like that on a strength, that's what you're gonna need to do, you know. And even still, like, it's a crazy request to ask, because again, I'm assuming while those citizens are there, they still weren't receiving benefits as citizens. You know what I'm saying? And we've heard testimony to that from the young lady who spoke about, you know, her journey. You know, and I think, and I don't know, I have to look back at that video clip, but, you know, I don't know if that was the same thing that what the lady was referring to when she got to the border, and it was the Ukrainian border, kind of like, you know, oh, we need, you know, we need this, or you need to be in a car in order to lead a country, and this, that, and the third. I know, luckily for that young man,
he was met with the same, okay, after she walked 12 hours, all right, there's a bus coming. And then she goes to get on the bus, and they're like, nah, only Ukrainian. It's like, I just walked 12 hours.
Right.
Well, when it at that point, it's a couple of things really, really, really quickly. The only thing I want to speak to on the first one, because Sam, I think you're my spirit animal today for some reason. You hit the nail on the head. But it's also, there's an emotional aspect to the things that we're seeing, right? Like, did you see the mother's response when her child made it home? That was a genuine response. Like, people were detaching the humane sides of these things. Like, these people belong to people. Like, I belong to my mama. Like, that baby, her baby came back to her. And you could see it that in just that response. But to that second video, exactly, E, you know, you got the unmitigated gall to ask me to pick up a gun and fight for you as a man, as a man. But they wouldn't let his wife and his daughter cross. How dare you? How dare you? So to Malik's point, Malik made an earlier point that, you know, prioritizing their people to get across. Nah, I come from the age of something for something. If you want me to fight for you, let my folks come across. Ain't no prioritization. People cross, period.
Mm-hmm. Or understand, honestly, now I get that that's your people, but you got to understand, you asking somebody from another country to come fight on your war. Where's the priority on that?
That's like the Titanic. That's like the Titanic or any ship, for example. You know, the captain's supposed to go down with the ship, right?
Yeah.
Right along with the crew. But you're supposed to evacuate your guests.
Yeah.
Right. Because it's their country, right? And if you're Ukrainian, born and raised, you're a citizen of that country. Those are the people who should stay and fight. If you're guests or you just come here to learn and go back to your country, you shouldn't have to be compelled to pick up arms for another country. That's just
as your guest too. When you let folks come over to your house, do you not show them where the restroom is so they can use the restroom should they need to? You give them certain privilege. You're like, yeah, I want to make you feel welcome. I'm going to make you feel at home.
Higher honor. We all know they get a higher level of respect and duty, as you know what I'm saying, invitee or a guest, versus if it was just, like we said, well, or guests rather, they're just a guest, but they their own business. So it's almost like they, you know, invitee, you know what I mean? And not to get too legally on it, but we know that, you know, when people are coming, you offer your country to them for them to continue to get their education, I'm assuming at a school that you're offering. So, you know what I'm saying? Again, That's bringing things. You're inviting those people to come here to learn, to do things. You're asking them to come to your country as a guest, and then for you to treat them like that, you know, again, it just shows how things can go sometimes within our people being here. But I'm going to go to one last clip real quick, which reference a gentleman who referred to.
There were some reports about discrimination of people with Arabic or African roots. What can you tell us about that? Is this true? Did you experience something like this?
Yes, I experienced that. There's a lot of hostility from the white women. They really don't like us to be in the train. Somebody was telling me I have to stand up, I have to go out. If I don't, I'm not a Ukrainian, I shouldn't be in the train of a Ukrainian. I should find anywhere I should go to. So it's really, really, really sad that we have to face this. And they prefer their pets, their animals, even before a black man or a black woman. So it's really sad. I'm really traumatized, first of all. I really understand women first, then children first, then men, but not animals.
There were some reports about discrimination of people with Arabic or African roots.
Oh, yeah. So I think this goes to the global mistreatment of Blacks across the world. You know, we have a plethora of examples. This Ukraine is just a reminder of that, right? So here in the U.S., right, we got rid of those Haitian immigrants that were fleeing due to, you know, a lot of conflict that was going on here in the United States. They were removed rather quickly. Everybody was like, oh, what happened to those thousands and thousands of immigrants? Overnight, they were gone, right? The U.S. got them out like this. And they're always saying, we have a lot of Hispanics here that keep crossing the border, all this other stuff. If the United States wanted to get rid of certain people, they know how to. And when you're Black, they remove you rather quickly when they want to remove you. Another example, right? South Africa, right? The apartheid, right? They have Blacks separate from whites, right? And Blacks tend to live in more of the ghettos, the slums and stuff like that. So that's well known and documented. And we can even go to Australia, right? The Aboriginal people, they're being mistreated and they have to fight for their rights constantly, getting money for lands taking, et cetera, and things like that. And another example in the Caribbean, once again, even Dominicans, right? Even when you're like mixed or mestizo, or you don't claim yourself to be Black, you're still discriminating against people who claim to be Black, which is the Haitians in that case, where you're sending, when you're deporting Haitians who were born and raised in Dominican Republic, speak Spanish, they don't even know French or Creole, and you're just deporting them because they have Haitian roots. So it's like, this is all over the world. This is a global mistreatment. And that clip is just an example of, you know, Black people, how Black people are treated across the globe, and, you know, the reputation of Blacks, you know, how, you know, we're always trying to struggle to, you know, make a way, and we're always getting mistreated. I think it's time that we try to change that narrative. That's why it's important for some of these African nations to actually really get it together and treat their citizens better to improve our reputation globally. That's why I think once Africa gets it better, gets itself together, like most of the African countries that are predominantly Black, I think that would help change our reputation globally and help have a better impact on the world.
Well, let me bail you out really quickly. So we're talking about how that the second video Everett shared, where the gentleman was almost, it was almost laughable that they asked him to fight. So there are some Nigerians that actually want to fight for Ukraine. Do you know they are charging these people $1,000? I'm willing to die for your cause, charging me $1,000. They're about to have to pay a ticket and their visa to fight.
Wow. Oh, you know, I thought I heard so that the Ukrainian government was willing to do something like to offer, like, you know what I'm saying, that maybe offset that. I'll have to double check that, but.
Well, this is as of 2 days ago.
They were requesting people.
See, that goes to my point of, you know, that's a shame on African governments that you have citizens willing to get paid from another country to actually go fight for them. But, I mean, that shows you the state of what that country is right now.
Hold on. No. Nigerians have to pay
to fight. Oh, Nigerians have to pay. Oh, sorry.
Have to pay to fight. That's what I thought you said. Okay.
Are they
fight for Ukraine?
Yeah, sorry. I misheard you.
$1,000 for
it. Who's charging them that, Shante?
Say again.
Who's charging them that money?
Ukraine.
Oh, then they don't want me to fight then.
Listen to what Sam said earlier ago. There's so many, just because we're in a conflict, the racism, the blatant racism, the microaggressions, the macroaggressions, like it's all still very prevalent. I'm willing to die for you, and you still finna charge me? You're finna charge me. And you're not finna let my folks go across. And if I don't want to, you basically want me to try to make me.
You gonna charge me $1,000? First of all, you want me to put my life on? Let me rephrase it.
Hold on. I got.
Hey, global racism doesn't sleep.
Hold on. What you say, E?
I got the article right here.
Okay.
Punch.com. Can y'all see everything?
Yeah, there it is.
That's
a hard no for me, right?
If I'm hard
to put my life on the line. You gonna tell me I gotta pay you $1,000 for a ticket and a visa? I'm coming to put my life on the line. That right there tells me that you don't think my life is worth it.
Oh, okay.
It's not
but
worth
it. But then too, I'm looking at the Nigerians.
Okay, but
why are you coming
to go to my point though? Right, that? They have to pay the $1,000, but as I'm skimming through this, they're gonna be getting paid. Well, at first it was $7,000. And now it's $3,000.
They shouldn't have to pay anything.
That's true, but like it still goes back to my point of like, okay, there's a salary incentive. So even if you do pay $1,000, you still get either $6,000 or you get
$2,000. But it offsets it, Malik, though. It offsets it.
I mean, it does offset it, but it's
no. I'm not
like a financial incentive for these people to try to go fight for them.
That's not a financial
But listen real quick, ladies, listen real quick. Could you imagine them trying to offer like Everett and I only $1,000 to go fight for them? We would laugh, but as a Nigerian, you might
But they're not offering. But Malik,
but they're not offering you.
I mean, not offer $1,000. I mean, $7,000, right?
If you got a job offer that said you got to pay me $1,000 to work here, you're going to get a check every 2 weeks, but you got to pay me $1,000 to work here. Would you take that job?
But my point is, my quick point is that they wouldn't even offer Everett and I something ridiculous like that, like pay $1,000, then we're going to give you $7,000 a month. We wouldn't take that.
Now, they might offer it, but like you said, will we take it is a totally different story. But I want to say too, to that point, though, real fast, to what you were just saying. I think we have to look at it because it is some parts true that Ukraine was offering to pay, and then at the same time, they're also saying that you have to pay to get to come over. Now, the one thing I'll say, the reason why, although that seems like a lot and it may be absurd, in essence, I think when you look at it from the standpoint of if you're giving me maybe an advance prior to so that I can pay that, or you're going to deduct that out the, you know what I'm saying, first check, okay, cool. Because people do pay for jobs. Like you might have to pay for fingerprinting before, you might have to pay for a background check or something like that before you can get a job. A lot of times, normally they do for some of the background checks, but fingerprinting, that's something that you normally might have to do. So there are some times that we have to pay for things in order to get employment. So I'm not gonna say that that's truly crazy, but the fact that you know you asking somebody when you in a time of war to come off, you know what I'm saying, to come off some money instead of just trying to weigh that factor and just hope that you're getting people who have war experience and trying to get them in there with like a more aggressive recruitment. That part of it is a little bit more.
And it's what you're charging them for, right? Like you just said that. It's not like I'm going to get fingerprinted and making sure I'm good. You're charging me for a visa and a ticket. Those, first of all,
I mean, generally, you do have to pay for that.
When you want the United States to step in and come help you in your war, you don't ask the United States military to pay you $1,000 per soldier for a visa and a ticket. You put them on a plane, you send them over there, they get to fighting, and whoever makes it back comes home. That's that. It's funny. Like, that's ridiculous. That's absolutely ridiculous. And you're doing it to Nigerians. Are you doing it to anybody else? Have you done that? Is that offer even made to anybody else?
That was my point. Like, is that offer even extended to the problem.
Yeah, racism doesn't take any days off. And so with that being said, I'm going to segue into the next portion. Well, we're talking about the contrast between white nations versus black nations in times of conflict. So, you know, when you hear about conflicts in the Middle East or conflicts in Africa, it's always, oh my God, it's so dangerous. Oh, you know, you've got these people, it's a poor country and blah, 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 even though it might not even be that poor. Oh my God, it's just so bad and dangerous and blah, 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 blah. And now, you have something going on in Ukraine, which is a predominantly white country. And it's, oh my God, this is a civilized nation. Who are you to determine what's civilized and what's not? You see what I'm saying? Why? Is it because it's in Africa? Or is it because it's in the Middle East? But now here you will have a predominantly white place and you're talking about how, oh my God, no, this is not okay. This is terrible. These people are civilized. This is an established country. I don't care if it's established or not. They're in wartime. And so make it seem like it's worse in one place versus another just because of the economy of that place.
Yeah.
War is war. You know, and you see it a lot when you're looking at a lot of these news media outlets, where they're talking about Trevor Noah did a segment about that. And it was, you can tell he was clearly upset. Of course, he made jokes because he's a comedian, but it was very, 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 very upsetting because it's like you just keeps, and I think Amanda Seales also had commented on it. Like, stop trying to make it seem like it's different because it's in a different type of a country. I don't care what's going on in the country, who the country is made up of. It's a war. It's going to be difficult, period. You see what I'm saying? And I think that people need to open their eyes and stop with the racism stuff because it's ridiculous.
No, absolutely. And I mean, while I know what we just heard in regards to, well, twofold, to the thing that we were just saying, like, I think when we look at it all and you see, you're absolutely correct. I think a lot of times because other countries and their governments, you know what I'm saying, have regulations in regards to, like, you can't just openly recruit U.S. soldiers. Like, you know what I'm saying? You can maybe ask, you know, the government to send you over some troops, but you can't just openly just say, like, hey, you know, people that's active in. And I think that's why that request was for someone who was no longer active in, you know, Nigerian war. So maybe like contractors or mercenaries or people of that nature would be the individuals that they're looking to try to seek to hire for these type of assignments. But again, those individuals are likely probably receiving big money to do a lot of private type of security guards and things for other individuals. So I don't know if that's enough. That's why it's like it's maybe just enough for individuals in developing nations to feel like, okay, you know what? Hey, this is the thing. And then you got to think about that last statement too. How are we when we're in a place in which people have to feel like they have to put their life on the line in order for them to make a living for their family? And I know a lot of times we feel like, you know, people do that here, and it's genuinely the people that's breaking laws to try to make a living for themselves. But as we see, and like I said, even in America, we see a lot of people taking those chances because when you don't have and you are without, you know, you don't necessarily see a future without the current, in the current state, you're desperate and you might be willing to do, you know, things just because you are in a squalid place of money. And I think that's what Malik was making a statement of saying, like, you know, when you don't feel like you have to have that desperation, you're not going to be so eager to just jump on something that just doesn't seem to be something that makes sense, right? And I think a lot of times because they're just so used to people, you know, just accepting whatever, that they think that that's something that would be appropriate, as opposed to, again, either taking a side, maybe joining NATO if that's what they have to do in order to get, you know, that that help that they need and the defense that they want. They want to remain, you know, on their own and be able to make the decisions that they want to make, you know, then they have to stand on their decisions and live by that. So as far as the solution for that situation, you know, which is tough because, again, it's looking like the manpower isn't there. That's a real hard situation in that regards, because it's looking like you either going to need to fold on one thing and give up some power and hegemony in order to and link with NATO, or, you know, stand out here on your own and do what you can until the situation may change. So, like I said, as far as that solution, I really don't necessarily know, because this is what we're looking to see. If they can come up and pull one of those David and Goliath moments and, you know, conquer Russia. But I know we see here a lot of people sitting there and cheering for Ukraine and hoping that they come through, but we're going to see exactly how far that extends, which we've started to see that with, like Malik said, policies and bills passing for providing funds. And also even I've seen that they also were looking to offer housing or, you know, offer asylum for some citizens, if I'm not mistaken. I have to double check. But yeah, so those are the things that I think.
Let me jump in here real quick, E, on something about Ukraine real quick. Ukraine isn't so innocent here. I know the media, the world media, the you know, global propaganda that's promoting, you know, Ukraine such the victims. Maybe they are in this case, but they're not clean, right? They have a history of racism, right? They even at one of their sporting events, one of the government officials proposed that we segregate the whites from the blacks, right? They have a lot of Nazi roots, right? And white supremacists infiltrated into their system. So yeah, I think even Putin made mention of that, which is pretty true based off of a lot of our reports and instances of, they have a lot of history of racism. So Ukraine's not so squeaky clean. So as Black people, I think we should stay out of conflicts like that, right? And we can learn from conflicts like this, right? Like, for example, these Black countries and Black people need to be prepared. I think everybody just needs to be prepared, because if you look at what happens to other countries that don't have the military strength as Russia, or you know, the resources that Russia has, they get bullied. All right. When you go against what I guess you could say NATO or other countries want to do, their plan, they get bullied. But in this case, Russia is able to get their way in some aspects because they have the weaponry. They're prepared in some extent, right? Even though the media doesn't want to let us believe that they're losing, they're unprepared, everything is going wrong. But that's not, I don't think that's the case. Everything's not going, maybe everything's not going their way, but I don't think everything's going wrong in terms of the situation. But as far as solutions,
wait a second, hold on for a second. What do you mean by things not going their way, but not going?
Well, in the media, they're saying Putin's plans, they said it would be short, things would be over in a week, you know, but I think maybe they're not going according to his plan, but I don't think everything's going in Ukraine's favor either. Like, Ukraine's okay, just beating back the Russians. Like, they're asking for Nigerians to join the fight. I mean, that kind of tells you how well things are going. Right, they're asking for outside parties to help. They're begging the U.S. They're not even part of NATO, so they're on their own with this stuff, right? So they should have joined NATO. Russia probably would have took a little bit more time in considering attacking, because then that means there would have been World War III, right?
Yep.
So nobody wants that to happen. They would have had to do something else, but in this case, Ukraine's not part of NATO, so they're on their own, right? You know, and Russia has nuclear weapons, so nobody wants to, you know, start another major war with people who have nuclear weapons. And, you know, they're threatened that they'll use some of their powerful weapons, because Russia has developed, you know, one of the strongest nuclear bombs in history alongside the United States. So we don't want those two countries going to war. And I know they've said a lot of, you know, jarring words and very threatening words to each other from their government and military officials. But hopefully that type of conflict doesn't happen, right? We always want to be more diplomatic about things, diplomacy, peaceful negotiations, stuff like that. So I think to avoid these type of conflicts, I think we just need to work with more diplomatic solutions, not war solutions. Be prepared just in case there has that the other side just refuses to cooperate. And I think one lesson that I think a lot of countries need to learn is you can see why North Korea, Iran, and other smaller countries want nuclear weapons, because you see how Russia is able to just do whatever, and, you know, all they're getting is sanctions, right? So it's not like there's other countries bombarding them and attacking them. Like for example, we can compare it to the Libya situation. When Libya was fighting back against insurgency, Muammar Gaddafi situation, other countries intervened, right? Saying, oh, that's not right, you shouldn't do that with your citizens, and they intervened. When the U.S. does something to citizens or mistreatment, no other country intervenes. So it's important to build up your military and build up weapons, apparently, because other countries will stay out of your business. So I think that's what we learned here.
Let me jump in too real quickly, Jim. One of the things I did notice too was it was an article that was posted recently in the U.S. News that talked about, you know, what the U.S. was doing to kind of assist with the efforts of the Ukrainian in this war. And one of the things that was stated was that they offered $56,000 in food and assistance to the residents within the Ukraine. And then also they stated that within the US government, they budgeted at least visas for 125,000 citizens to be entered into the US this year, which again was a record number because it was cut down recently by Donald Trump to around 15,000 citizens. So now we're gonna be allowed to be coming in from other countries. And within that 125,000, it was stated that 76 of those 1,000 were from Afghan already. So now the next question becomes, will the U.S. prioritize individuals that are flying from Europe or within the Ukraine, or are they going to allow other citizens to be able to enter in? And that's one thing that we definitely have to look for, because, again, one of the things we always talk about within this country and us being able to try to have resources that we need to have for, you know, individuals, especially like within the Black community who have built up this country, who have not been able to receive 48 people and who have not been able to receive the promises that this government has had, or addressing to redlining the other type of systematic issues that they've had that we faced within this country. We look at, you know, adding in another 125, you know, 1,000 refugees from other countries and what that might bring into the country. And I do know that that's not necessarily a significant number in regards to how many people are already currently here, but in regards to now having to have, you know, individuals who may be relying upon the system in order to get themselves going, or trying to find ways within this country to get ahead if they were able to kind of get, to get ahead. And we're facing already a shortage within jobs, or not necessarily a shortage in jobs, but a shortage of employment within certain people that's already within this country. Those factors need to be looked at. And I know that sounds kind of like a traditionalist. It sounds like someone who maybe feels like they're coming from a place of privilege, like how we would look at someone from, like you said, like the Confederate, in the sense of just saying like, oh, we shouldn't let others in because it's going to prevent us from getting what we have to get. But I think in this regard, we do need to look at how preventing other people from coming into this country and being able to focus on the issues in which we have with citizens that's already primarily here, that definitely needs to be something that's going to address, because it's going to continue to push and push to push the things further and further apart, because now you're going to have more and more people in these countries who aren't necessarily qualified to maybe do certain types of jobs and things of that nature to bring in certain type of assets to the country. So then you're going to have shortages of, and I think that this is what this, who this really impacts, is individuals who maybe don't have specialized types of skill sets and employment from being able to find those type of jobs, those type of
I think we're jumping to conclusions with that. I think we have to wait to see what happens when people get here before we start making that determination about whether or not they have the appropriate skill sets for certain jobs. But also too, as something related to something Malik said when he was talking about sanctions, it's not like the sanctions are minor, like they're huge sanctions. And on top of those sanctions, businesses are pulling out of doing business with Russia. And Putin is very rich. Russia is a very rich country. But when you start talking about Visa and MasterCard, Apple, like major companies who make major money are pulling out of doing business in Russia. And so you can't fund a war if you ain't got no money. You know, I mean, and when I see it, it's like, yeah, although the United States hasn't militarily got involved, all of these other sanctions have the potential to assist in debilitating. I'm not going to say completely debilitate, but assist in debilitating Russia's, you know, ability to continue to move forward as to what's going on in Ukraine. But as it relates to solutions for the global impact of the way Black people are mistreated around the world, I think number one, I agree with Malik when he's talking about, you know, African countries needing to do better for their people, but I think everybody's better for Africans. You know, Africans have been through so much, and I think that also too, Africans have to do better for Africans. We have to, and when I say Africans, I don't mean just people from the continent of Africa. I mean people.
Oh, diaspora, you're talking about?
I'm talking about the entire diaspora, people of African descent. We need to be better people. We need to unify. We need to be educated, and we need to stop being so divided. Right, like the black book of the month last month was a book where it talked a lot about how African nations, how there was dynasties in African nations for years, and the reason why they could not be infiltrated is because they were unified, and the minute they were divided, they were conquered. And Black folks have not been able to get back on their feet ever since, and that's just as a whole. And I think as a global solution, we're on here, we're talking about it. Other Black people in America are talking about it, but we got to be able to be better for people. One of the things that I do recall is during the pandemic, when Black folks start, when Africans really started seeing the mistreatment of Black people here in America, there were certain countries that were saying, hey, y'all can come on home. Y'all can come here. And so it's not to say that, you know, we're not there for each other. We just need to be there for each other on a bigger scale. And we have to stop fighting with each other. I mean, is there more than one way to skin a cat? Yes, but we gotta get together first before we can figure out the proper way, what's gonna work. And that's my idea about solutions. I mean, it goes to be a lot more difficult, but that's just what I think.
May I interject right here in this particular segment, because you said something strong and I want to speak to the diaspora of Black people. What we all need to do, Black, when I say Black, and like you said, I mean all of us, we need to really study how these countries historically treat Black people before we go there. You know, historically, how did Ukraine treat Black people before we send our babies over there to learn? Because we're going to be subjecting, you know, we're okay with subjecting our babies to certain things that, you know, and we haven't looked at the history of it. You know, it was to a point to where they should have looked at a lot of things before we got here, you know, but obviously, you know, we all didn't get here by choice. to get to America by choice, but I'm pretty sure, you know, if just to look at, you know, while slavery was going on, Africans weren't readily sending their babies over to America because they were looking to see how Black people were treated over here. So, you know, that I think that is a big solution to, I won't say a big solution. I think it's something that we could think of as far as solutions are concerned. Stop putting our resources there as Black people, you know, stop sending our children there. My child is a resource. You know, so I'm not sending my baby to your country if you don't know how to treat her, if you don't know how to treat him. So yeah, that's just one of mine I got.
Yeah, I agree. You know, we definitely need to make sure we're doing that research before we go places. Because there's nothing wrong with wanting to be versed and learn more about different cultures and things like that. But you definitely want to make sure you're not being mistreated in the process, right? Because if you're going to be mistreated, just read it in a book. You know, we also have this segment, like I just mentioned a few minutes ago, we talk about a book of the month. This month, it is Black Labor, White Wealth. It is a research for power and economic justice. And it's written by Claude Anderson. It's a book that we definitely recommend everybody read. We have the book, and I definitely think that everybody should go ahead and take a look at it because it teaches us how to grow economically, socially, as Black people. Also, two, our Black Business of the Month is a business called Observe Me. And this is an athletic wear business. It's Black owned and it's also woman owned. So shout out to the ladies. Happy Women's Month. Let's not forget that it is Women's Month. But it's called Observe Me. They have athletic wear. It's good for people that do run and things like that. Shout out to Karen Foltz. She was actually one of our professors in law school and is her clothing line. So we wanted to go ahead and make sure we highlighted them. You will see the website pop in any minute now. And so with that, we're just gonna move on to the motivational minute. And E has that for us today. I'm you, E.
Yeah, so for today's motivational minute, I just wanted to say to kind of encourage anyone that to understand that, you know, with the strength that you have and the fortitude that you have and within being Black, to understand that that it's a blessing, you know what I'm saying, to be able to be this strong and to have to endure what you have to endure and to do it within such grace. I also want to encourage people to understand that when we look around, to be mindful of the fact that what you have, especially because a lot of our viewers are likely in the U.S., what you have and the privileges that you have within this country, even as slight as they may seem, it's still a privilege. And that, you know, when we look around and now that we are able to see things a lot quicker, we have a lot faster access to seeing, like you said, the journey for two brothers of ours and sisters of ours within the diaspora and their experiences that they have had to endure and leaving. We have to understand, because a lot of us, we like to travel. A lot of us like to, you know, go around and travel abroadly. So as we go and we're doing these luxury TikToks and this and that and videos and things of that nature, we have to be mindful of that, you know, being aware of where we are and also understanding that treatment kind of goes without. I know we talked about this in the past, but like you said, it doesn't matter if you're Oprah to OJ to whomever else. There's constant reminders that fame and celebrity is not going to be one thing that's going to allow you to overcome this, your Blackness. Like some will say, your spouse or whoever you marry is not something that's going to allow you to outcome your Blackness. Your position, your title, your class, whatever it is that you have is not going to allow you to outcome your Blackness. So I think when we have that in mind, I think we all need to be able to understand that it doesn't matter where someone is from or what they do or whatever the case may be. If they look like you, if they, you know what I'm saying, maybe speak a different language, but look like they know, like you said, they're Dominican or they're Haitian or whatever the case may be, understand that there's a uniqueness that we all share when it comes to when there's moments in time in which things are getting really serious, that you'll see that, you know what I'm saying, that unites us more than so many other things. So I just want to encourage everybody to be mindful of that, be thoughtful of that, as we move through, and so that we can try to find a way to kind of have a better understanding and unity when we see people in time of need, and as our people, so that we can come through and hold either their countries accountable or ours, if it's ours and it's our citizens that we see needing assistance. So that's my motivational minute for the minute this week, and I just hope that encourages us all to kind of, you know, take a better stance at understanding where we are in the world and understanding what our position is, and then understanding what we need to do moving forward so that we can ensure that, you know, we speak to those injustices, and that we also take actions towards making sure that we hold those powers that be accountable for making sure that those injustices do not incur. Whether that's, you know, in this case, the Nigerian government, you know, asking them to kind of step up for their citizens, or the Guyanese government, or whoever else it is that those citizens are from that are in Ukraine trying to get over on down the line to wherever the next injustice may occur.
Yeah, so, you know, we hope that our African brothers and sisters get out of Ukraine. That's just number one. And number two, we just hope that everything works out the way that it should. I mean, it's not in our hands, it's in God's hands, but faith without works is dead. So we got to make sure we do what we can to, you know, help one another. So with that said, we want to thank you all for tapping in. We know we've been on here for a little over an hour, but it was a good conversation. We want to shout out to Shantae. Thank you again for joining us again. All of our socials are going to be posted at the end, so you guys can make sure you like, share, subscribe, follow us. All that good stuff. We love y'all, and thank y'all again for joining our Counterpoints podcast.
Thank you, guys. Peace.